Hi, I'm Scott Dietrich, offensive coordinator at Parkview Baptist High School in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And today I'm going to share with you the first in a series of videos featuring our combination triple option offense. And in this first video, we'll feature our base play, the play in which our offense is built around, which is the combination triple option and adjustments that we make off of that play. We'll also look at a few offensive basics and techniques that go into perfecting this play. First thing, I'd like to thank American Football Monthly for the opportunity to share this information in this series with you. I know personally I've benefited from many of their fine resources, and it's my hopes and wishes that you benefit from this information that I'm presenting to you as well. At Parkview, we've been running this offense for about 9 years. During that time, I've also been a part of this offense 11 years. During that time, we've been very, very successful with this offense. It's been very productive for us. Over a 9-year period, we've been able to maintain a high level of consistency. We've averaged about 35 points a game, and well over 350 yards per game offensively. Also during that time, we've won 99 games, 18 losses. We've been to the playoffs all 9 years. During that stretch, we've also been to the quarterfinal round of the playoffs 7 out of the 9 years, and we've also won 2 state championships, the most recent being in 2007, which we were able to go 15-0. The offense has been very, very productive for us, been able to maintain a high level of consistency, and something I believe in personally as a coach. I wouldn't want to run any other offense. I've had the opportunity, like I said, to run about 11 years, and it's something we greatly believe in. It's been very good to us. In running the combination triple option offense, there are some things why we really like this offense. The first of which is I think it's a very unselfish, team-oriented offense. When you look at the nature of this offense, we're not asking any one player to win or lose the game for us on offense. We're looking at all 11 players doing their jobs and helping our team win. The other thing we like about it is it really helps our team concept. We are a ball control offense. We try to grind the football out. We'll take big plays when the opportunity presents itself. But more times than not, we're a time of possession football team, which really helps your defense. In this age of spread offenses, we see a lot of teams with very good athletes that are trying to spread the field and exploit your athletes. So by keeping their offenses on the sideline, we really give ourselves the best chance to win. In this past season, we've averaged about 30 minutes of possession time out of 48 minutes. So it's pretty substantial in terms of keeping their offense off the field. The other reason we really like our offense is for personnel reasons. We feel like we don't have to be great anywhere on offense when we select personnel. We feel like the positions and team things that we're asking our players to do, we can coach them to do. We're not asking them to be exceptional athletes. We also feel like it's easier to fit personnel into our offense. If you take, for example, the slots, and we run out of a double slot formation, if you take, for example, our slots, it's easier to find kids and ask them to do things that a slot back has to do compared to maybe a true tailback or a true tight end, things of that nature. We also like this offense because of the way it makes the defense play. Defenses these days want 11 athletes on the field. They want to fly to the football, pursuit drills, and really, really take off where the ball goes. But when they come across an option team like us, they really have to slow themselves down. They have to account for the dive, the quarterback, and the pitch, every single play, and that really makes them slow down and play differently than they like to play. The other thing is we feel like it's hard to prepare for in a 3-day week. Many times, we may be the only option team on a team schedule. With spread offenses and multiple offenses, we may be the only time they have to prepare for the option game. So they don't see it much, so there's not very much familiarity with it. As a result, defensive coaches have to decide, number one, how they want to defend it, and number two, they have to try to prepare a scout team in a short amount of time, which we feel like is very difficult. And the last reason we like it is a very quick-hitting attacking offense. Our fullback is lined up very close to our quarterback, and most of our plays begin with him attacking the line of scrimmage. We feel like by not taking the football off the line of scrimmage very often, it gives us the best opportunity to keep the chains moving, keep the clock moving, and going north and south. So these are the reasons we really like the multiple slot option offense, which we feature our combination triple option play. Okay, now we'd like to take a look at personnel in each offense Every team has to decide what they're looking for in particular positions when they're placing personnel. As said earlier, we're going to run our offense every year and put the players where they fit. We also like to take a look at our stance and alignments and some formations and things we do alignment-wise. Let's start up front. The first thing we want to do is identify what we're looking for up front. As far as in a perfect world or what we're looking for in an ideal situation, our guards and our centers need to be our bigger, stronger, more physical drive-blocking linemen. If we have a difference in linemen, that's what we're looking for there, particularly our guards and our center. Many times these positions are covered by the defense with down linemen, and it's very important that they be able to hold their ground and get movement there at the point of attack. Our tackles can be a little bit lighter, more athletic linemen, for the simple fact that many times they're chasing linebackers. We don't do a lot of pulling, but if we do, it's primarily with tackles. We also pull them on our rocket toss that we'll look at in our third video. And we also put them in position on pass protection where they're isolated on defensive ends many times. So we're looking at a little more athletic linemen there. All of our linemen are in basically the same stance, three-point stance with probably 60, 65% of their weight forward on their hands. We are a run-blocking team. We're going to be weight forward heavy coming off the football. As far as our horizontal and vertical splits and alignment, we're a two-foot split team across the board on both sides. We don't believe in really adjusting our splits a lot. We want to be able to run everything from a base alignment as much as possible everywhere. But we're a two-foot split team. As far as a vertical alignment, the helmet of our guards and tackles are to be even, probably about the armpit of our center. So we're up more on the ball than we're off it. We do try to work on getting our linemen back a little bit more for zone and scoop purposes and things like that. But if you look at us, when you look at us on film, you'll see our linemen are more up than they are off. Talk about a tight end position. Our tight end, we're double slot, double split, which we call ace. We do run a tight end a lot. This past season, we went to a lot of two tight end sets. But when I talk to coaches about a tight end set, many times they'll say, you know, I don't have an ideal tight end or true tight end. We don't either. Our tight ends are hybrid players. They may be a big split end that can come inside and do what we ask them to do. It may be a sixth or seventh offensive lineman that's not in the starting rotation that can learn that position. What we ask our tight end to do is a kind of a combination between what a tackle does and what a slot back does. So we really think a tight end can fit into the offense. As far as our slots, and let me say this about the tight end. When you see us on film, our tight ends are in a two-point stance. We actually don't put them down in a three-point stance, so they look more like a slot. The reason we do this is we trade and walk the tight end quite a bit. We also ask them to block out on strong safeties and linebackers many times, and we found that this block is easier to do from a two-point stance. Our two slots, which are interchangeable, we basically line them about a half a yard and a half a yard off of the near tackle's foot. We're in a two-point stance with our shoulder square to the line of scrimmage. As far as what we're looking for from our slots, we talk to them all the time about they don't have to be great at anything, but they have to be good at a lot of things. Your slots have to be smart as a quarterback. They have to understand fronts and secondaries. They have to be smart enough to understand and remember the motion system. They're part of your inside and outside running game. They're part of your inside and outside blocking game. And they also try to implement those guys in the passing game. So very versatile players, but we've had tall, skinny kids to small, dumpy kids run this position. So it can be a very versatile position as far as what you're looking for. As far as our fullback position, our fullback lines up with his hands 2 yards from the heels of the quarterback. And he's in a narrow stance, a stance that's going to allow him to come off similar to a track athlete who's running out of blocks. We want him with a good tilt, almost like a lineman stance, except his feet are much more narrow. As far as what we're looking for from a fullback, he's kind of a combination of an old eye fullback and a true tailback. We want a kid that's tough, but that can run like a tailback, almost as good as a tailback. He's got to be able to be tough enough to dent the line of scrimmage between the tackles, and durable enough to last the whole season. And we have a fullback right now that'll be a 3-year starter that does a great job. As far as our quarterback, all the intangibles you talk about with quarterback apply to us. We want a kid that is respected, that's a leader, that learns and knows your offense like a coach. But the three things we tell our quarterback besides athletic ability is he's got to be a competitor, he's got to be tough, and he's got to be a decision maker. We can't have a kid in there that lacks confidence or can't make a decision, make a bad decision, and rebound from it. So the more athletic he is, the better your offense is, but we can survive with an average kid there as long as he does those other things I mentioned. Split ends. Our split end position is a little bit different than most offenses. We would love to have tall, fast, athletic wideouts like anybody. But in reality, these kids are going to be asked to do a lot more blocking than they are anything. So the more unselfish that player is, the better he is. We got to find kids that are willing to do what we ask them to do. As far as formations, we start off in our ace. Ace is our base set, double slot, double split. We put our wideouts on the lineman. If the ball's in the middle of the field, our wideouts are going to be around the top of the numbers. As the ball moves toward the hash, the receiver to the field will be around the far hash. The receiver into the boundary will be around the bottom of the numbers, or splitting the difference between the numbers and the sideline. As I said earlier, we really don't try to over-adjust splits anywhere with our positions. We want to maintain normal splits as much as possible. We like this set for many reasons. And if somebody told me, Coach, you can only run one formation the rest of your career, it would be this formation. The reason I like this set, first of all, it's a balanced set. It makes the defense balance up. The next thing I like about it is a four-back, when you count the quarterback, it is a four-back and a four-receiver offense all in one. No other formation can really give you those benefits. We can attack the defense with any four of our backs, and we can attack vertically quick with our four receivers as necessary. Now, we all know you're in this offense to run the football first, but you do always have that run-pass threat in this formation. The other thing we like about it, because it's balanced, we can run everything to both sides. So when a defensive coordinator looks at our ace set, he has to prepare for all of our running plays, passing plays to both sides every snap. Besides our ace set, we'll take a look at a couple of other balanced sets that we get in. And just for simplicity, I'll keep everything right-handed. Another balanced set we'll get in is simply with a tight end instead of a split end. It's still a balanced set, but to one side we have a tight end wing look. To the other side we have a split end slot look. When we have a tight end, our slots by normal alignment are lined up almost directly behind our tight end. That's what it should look like. Another balanced set that we'll get into is what we call two tights or tight. And that's what we look like. We actually implemented this set quite a bit this past year for personnel reasons. This set was very good for us in the playoffs in the last 5-6 games of the year. Next, we'll look at unbalanced sets. As far as unbalanced sets, we have three categories of formations. Going back to our ace set, eliminate the tight ends. Okay. First thing we do to get unbalanced is we'll bring a split end over. Okay, we'll bring a split end over. Unbalanced is any formation that has four people on the line of scrimmage to one side. When we bring our split end over, we have that. Now, we know he's ineligible as a receiver, but we use him a lot of time for blocking purposes. We can even run a reverse with him and different things of that nature. But this is an unbalanced set. We can also be unbalanced in this same look with a tight end. That gives us an unbalanced look. The other unbalanced set we get into is out of our two tight set, a set in which we call heavy. We have four down linemen near the line of scrimmage or near the football. So that's an example of an unbalanced set. Going back to our ace look, the last category of formations we get in is what we call trips. Trips now affect the slot backs. When we bring this slot over into this alignment, that gives us a true trips with a split end on the backside. All the receivers are eligible. Now, for personnel reasons, one thing we do, if we have a better runner in here, one of our slots, and we ever have a better pass receiver in this position, then they're interchangeable. We would like to, every time we get in trips left or trips right, for our better receiver to be here and our better runner and blocker to be there. The other adjustment we make out of trips is we can put a tight end on the backside of the trips. Okay? The last formation we get into is a very special formation. It's a combination of unbalanced trips. We'll have a tight end with a trips alignment, and that's what that would look like. We don't do a lot of things out of this formation, but you can shift to it or walk to it or line up in it and kind of catch the defense offside, or excuse me, unaware of it. One thing, let me say this about formations. We don't run a lot of different formations, but every formation we run, we want to be able to run the majority of our offense out of it, but we must be able to run the triple option at least to one side, if not both sides, as well as the midline option. We want a defensive coordinator to have to defend those two plays as well as some other plays out of our offense. Unless we're, you know, doing some type of special or trick play, we won't get into a formation unless we can do those things. Okay, next what I'd like to do is take our combination triple option play and show you exactly what it is in terms of comparing it to inside and outside veer plays separately. I know a lot of triple option coaches run inside veer, maybe outside veer as two separate plays. We run it as one play and feel like we try to get the best of both worlds in one. Compared to the inside and outside veer plays, one thing, and this is concepts that we try to stick to, we want to have one mesh point on triple option. This is our mesh point. We're running right through the B gap to the inside half of the tackle. And because of inside veer, teams hit a little bit tighter. Outside veer teams may hit more in the C gap. We feel like by having one mesh point gives us consistency in our reads, our quarterback reaction, as well as our fullback reaction. I've been a part of inside and outside veer and can tell you it's hard to master those two mesh points combined with the midline, which is what most option coaches run this day as well. You know, the veer, inside veer tends to be a quick read, outside veer longer and slower. We have one mesh point. We try to keep it consistent and always the same. We also want to always protect the mesh. What I mean by that is we always want our lineman, let's say we're reading this defensive end, we want our lineman releasing inside the read and the fullback. We don't want to get into loop schemes where our mesh point or our fullback is totally unprotected from the dive key. So we always want to protect our mesh. We just feel like it really is a shot that your fullback doesn't have to take combined with all the other collisions that he absorbs during the year. We want to avoid fast double read pull pitch situations. Many times inside veer rules will put you, let's say a 50 defense, will put you reading a down lineman over the tackle, pitching off the next player. We feel like this is very fast and hard to handle sometimes, especially for young quarterbacks. We also want to avoid stack reads. Many times, let's say in a 4-3 defense, coaches will read the stack and read both those players. Again, for a young quarterback, I think that's difficult to do. So we're always just going to read one player. We're not going to read stacks. We don't want to be locked into an arc blocking scheme. I know a lot of inside veer teams, arc block and certain looks lock them into an arc scheme. We feel like we don't want to be dictated to and have to run arc blocking, especially if there's a mismatch between your slot and maybe who you're arcing to. We want our mesh point to be a B to C gap play. A lot of veer teams are running very tight, and it ends up being an A-gap play. We feel like for the A-gap, we have the midline, which attacks defense and A-gap where we want them to. Also, the other thing, and the last reason, concept that we stick to, by having one mesh and one triple option mesh to get the best of both worlds, we're able to maintain constant line splits. A problem that the inside and outside veer teams have is you go to the line of scrimmage with a huddle call of inside veer, and the defense lines up in a way that you want to run outside veer, you're not in the split conducive to run that. Or vice versa, you call outside veer, you get to the line, and you want to run inside veer, and your splits are too tight. So by having one mesh point and one read area, we're able to maintain consistent line splits. Okay, next we'll take a look at our quarterback, fullback mesh techniques, as well as our quarterback and our pitchback pitch techniques. I think it's very critical anytime you talk triple option football that you mention something about the mesh, because that's a critical component that can never be overlooked. The first thing is I think you should get your mesh down in the off season. You don't want to be going into spring ball or fall practice and the first thing you got to do is teach the mesh, because then your offense is on hold. Get it in place in the off season. We also think it's important that you get good at fundamentals before you introduce reads. It's a very frustrating thing if a quarterback's trying to still learn fundamentals as he's looking at reads. So we want to get the fundamentals down before we get the reads. The other thing we do interesting is I actually teach the mesh backwards. Through years of experience, a lot of frustration, a lot of fumbled balls, a lot of mistakes. We found that the best way to teach a mesh is take the quarterback and the fullback and actually hook them up in the first part of the mesh and let them go through it and feel what the mesh should feel like, both in the stance and where the football is. I think by doing that, then you gradually remove them one step, one step, one step until they're in their normal positions. But we actually teach it backwards. We hook them up first, let them feel what it should feel like so they know mentally what they're working for when they get in their normal stance. As far as our quarterback, the first thing we tell our quarterback is he's got to be decisive. And it all goes to a thought process. His thought process on a mesh read for the combination triple option is always think, give, react to a pull. In doubt, give the football. His first step, he's going to step about 3 o'clock, maybe a little deeper to the right. His first step, the ball and his eyes all work together. When he takes that first step, the ball goes back, his eyes go to the read area, and it's simultaneously. As he feels the fullback come over the ball, he's going to do what we call a momentum ride. He's going to ride with the fullback through his crease all the time while he's reading the dive key. We tell the quarterback, we don't teach a lot of different reads. When you deal with a football player, he's a lot of different things he can do to you. We focus on the one read that indicates a pull. Everything else is a give. For this, for a quarterback to pull the ball from the fullback, he has got to turn his head and shoulders. So we read the head and shoulder triangle. If he doesn't turn those head and shoulders and come down and take our fullback, we ought to be giving the football. And if he can arm tackle our fullback, we need to get another fullback. So it's a head and shoulder read. The only thing we tell him is make a decision while the ball is still in the framework of your body. Don't let the ball get outside your framework and still be undersided because it's going to be short to the fullback and he's not going to know if it's a give or a pull. When we do give the ball, we relax with our front hand and finish. If we pull the ball, we yank it out with two strong hands and explode to the pitch key. As far as our fullback, we're aiming through the B gap, through the inside half of the tackle. We're in a narrow stance. Both our fullback and our quarterback are fairly narrow in stance to allow them to get where they need to get on their first step. Our fullback's going to come off with a low pad level right through the B gap. And as that tackle's coming off the ball, if you were to stand behind the fullback, it's going to look like he's going right through the inside half of the tackle. That's his crease. He's going to expect the football every time. His first step's going to get him out of a stance. Second step, he's going to big pocket, soft squeeze and mesh with the quarterback. He's going to expect the ball. If he gets it, we tell him to hit that crease fast as he can and be a running back. Keep two arms on the football. Get your shoulder square as fast as you can. Have two arms on the ball until you get past the linebackers. If the ball is pulled from him, we either want him to square up hard or wrap around a pinch and dive key. That's what we tell the fullback. You can't rep that too much, enough. As far as the pitch phase of the option, once our quarterback gets a pull read, we're going to attack the pitch key. Now, one thing we tell our quarterback, again, all starts with a thought process, we want to be aggressive. I want my quarterbacks aggressive on a pull read. Think, run, and react to a pitch. We only have one pitch key on any option play. If that pitch key does not take him, he's running the football. He never pitches off anybody else. We're going to attack right down the middle of that pitch key, and we're going to make him make a decision. If there's any doubt, our quarterback's probably running the ball. A lot of coaches say, Coach, when do you tell him to pitch it? I tell him to pitch it at a point where he can't play both anymore. Do not let that pitch key play you and the pitch man. And it's kind of a two-on-one basketball concept. Be aggressive. Make him take you. If he doesn't, turn and run. We'll live with 4 and 5 yard gains all night long. Once we do get a pitch read from our pitch key, everything starts with the eyes. The quarterback's going to look, step, and he's going to pitch. We call it a thumb to the pitch man. He's going to actually extend a thumb to the pitch man, and we should follow the pitch. You'll see on video many times our quarterback makes a pitch and actually runs away from the pitch key to absorb the blow or never gets hit at all. And we really like that because it makes our pitch very accurate. Our pitch back is going to come in motion. We'll talk about that in a minute. He's going to flatten out. His job is to get 4 to 5 by 1 to 2 yard pitch relationship. 4 to 5 yards wide, 1 to 2 behind, and get into and maintain pitch relationship. Get his shoulder square, get his eyes on the football, expect the pitch. If he gets the pitch, we want to catch it and we want to stretch it and then become a running back. Hit the alley and hit it running. If we don't get the ball pitched to us, we should try to avoid the pitch key and get downfield and continue to play football until the play is over. And that's how we teach quarterback, fullback pitch and mesh techniques. Okay, what we like to do in this chapter is take a look at the combination triple option against the five main defenses. We have a very simple way of identifying defenses I'm very happy with, and it really makes things simple for our kids to be able to apply blocking rules to. We break defenses down into two categories, what we call eight-man fronts, which is 40, a 3-3, and a 5-1, and then seven-man fronts, which are two, which is a 4-3, and a 50. And we'll talk about the identifying characteristic of each as we get to them. We'll take the eight-man fronts for first. I think it's important that you can run your base play versus anything you see. I would hate to run an offense based around a play where defense finds out they won't run it against this look, and then you can't run your base play against everything. So we want to be able to make sure we run our base play, our combination triple option against everything. Give you our rules real quick. First thing, everything starts with rules. Our dive key is the second down lineman in any defense as a base rule. Our pitch key is what we call the force defender in any defense. Then our blocking is set from that. As a simple rule, our tackle is either going to veer to the play side backer or zone with the guard to the play side backer. As a base rule, our guard is either going to zone the first down lineman with the tackle or the center to the near linebacker, depending on the defense. If our center has a zero nose, he's going to scoop to backside with the guard, backside guard. If he is uncovered, he's going to zone play side. Our backside guard's rule is to cut off the number one down lineman or scoop with the center versus zero nose. Our backside tackle rule is to cut off the B gap, don't shorten the edge backside. And if we had a three technique backside, we could switch that with the guard and cut the three technique off with the tackle. And we'll take a look at those different rules as they come up. Our play side slot, we always run everything to the right for now, is what we call a wall chase block. He's going to work outside the dive key. He's going to wall the play side backer. The play side backer is blocked by the tackle or plugs. Then he's going to chase the free safety. One thing we don't tell our tackles to do is chase the free safety. I know some option teams do that. When our tackle's released inside or zone inside and the backer scrapes, we don't chase him. He's going to seal backside. We keep our lineman sealing the box, so to speak. Quarterback and fullback will mesh. Backside slot's going to pitch motion, just like we talked about earlier. Our play side receivers, if it's one safety, as in an eight-man front, he's going to stalk corner or run off a press corner. Our backside receiver is always chasing the middle third. So to put those rules against a 40 defense, dive key, he's second down lineman, 1-2. In an eight-man front, the rover is always the force defender. So there's your dive key, pitch key. In this case, tackle is going to veer to backer. He may scrape, he may get him. If the tackles head up to inside the guard, we're going to be zoning with the guard center, probably trying to work to backside backer. Cut off the first down lineman here. Cut off the B gap and climb. Don't shorten the edge. Quarterback, fullback mesh. Wall, chase. Stalk the corner. Cut off middle third. Quick motion to pitch. Now, one thing we tell our backside split in, this is an effort block. We want to sprint to the middle of the field. We want to be in a position to cut this corner off if we pop the fullback, quarterback, or the pitch man. So that's our blocking rule. And by the way, this is a 40 defense. The identifying characteristic on a 40 defense for us is there's no zero defender. That's the only defense where there's not a zero nose or a zero mic. Moving on with eight-man fronts, we'll get to a 3-3 defense. This is the defense we run at Parkview. Our defense coordinator does an excellent job with this defense, so it forced us to really learn about it. And we see it a few times during the year. It's still in the eight-man front family. So in the 3-3, we have to count a little bit different because there's only three down linemen. The way we teach a 3-3 is though they've taken the two tackles in a 40 and stacked them up in the middle. So the stack really now for us is like the first down lineman. Defensive end is second down lineman. It's dive key. Rover's always force, he's pitch key. Apply your same rules. Veer to play side linebacker if he scrapes. Backside backer. First down lineman's inside of him. So all we got to do is zone release to cut him off. Zero nose, center backside guard in a scoop. Cut off the B gap to climb. Play side slot's going to seal backer. Chase free safety if he can. Stalk corner, cut off. Fullback quarterback mesh. Motion to pitch. That's what we look like against a 3-3 defense, another version of an eight-man front. As far as the last eight-man front we see, we call a 5-1. Some teams call this a 5-3 defense. The identifying characteristic to us is similar to a 3-3. There's a zero stack, but there's also five down linemen. When we see this defense, they usually have what we call eagle down three techniques in here on the guard. It's a one safety defense. Okay, if we run this to the right, we don't count the stack as one in this case because we have a first, second down lineman. There's our dive key. Rover's always pitch key. All right, now with a three technique play side, what we do is we try to get that guard to come off and get 90% of that block. We want to dry block that three technique. Our tackle is not just going to turn his shoulders and double team a three technique. He's going to step with his play side foot, and on his second step, he's going to try to punch and clear that crease for the fullback if he has to. We don't see real wide three techniques because of our midline play we'll talk about later. But as a result, if he's working toward us, then we'll get a nice double team there trying to climb to this play side backer. If he is taken over by the guard, then the tackle will continue to climb. Center, backside guard are going to scoop a zero nose. This is a case where we get a switch block on the backside. Anytime we have a three technique, we want to be able to cut this off, and we have to get really low and try to scramble through his near hip. Play side slot, we make an exception against the 5-1 defense. When you look at a 5-1 defense, there's only one linebacker in the box. He's right over the football. He's their half and half player. One thing we tell our slot, against a 5-1 defense, we should be able to count on securing the mic with the guard and tackle blocking or the scoop, depending on what he's doing. So what we do is we take an arc chase. We take a best path, and we're going to get a hat on that free safety, which many times in the eight-man front is a heck of a player. So we don't even wall block against a 5-1. Stalk here, cut off backside, mesh, no change, motion to pitch, dive key, pitch key. That's one adjustment we make against a 5-1 defense that we really, really like as a result. Now let's move over to our 7-man fronts. There's 2 7-man fronts we identify. The first is a 4-3. The identifying characteristic of a 4-3 defense is a zero mic backer and four down linemen. Now, the thing about a 4-3, it can look a lot of different ways. Guys, you can have backers in the box, out the box. When we see a 4-3, it usually looks like this, stack linebackers. Now, you don't have rovers in the 7-man front, you have safeties. It's a 2-safety defense now. There's a lot of times these safeties are playing really tight. But the rules don't change, we just apply them a little differently. First, second down lineman is dive key. Pitch key is force. When it's a non-rover defense, the force defender can be him or him based on what the wideout does. When we tell our wideouts an option blocking, first of all, we have our inside foot back by our split ends. We could crack this only if it's clean. We're not a big crack blocking team. We will crack block, but we don't force it. So if we feel like we can get a hat on the safety and crack him as a better run defender, we will, and we'll make the corner of the pitch key. If he's uptight, maybe he's turned in where we can't crack him, or he's flying up on motion, we'll stay on the corner and we'll pitch off the safety. The good thing about this structure in the secondary is when the quarterback pulls the football, he's got time. It's not like a rover who's right on the line of scrimmage. He's got time to see who may be the split ends block. So his pitch key is off of him. In this case, we're going to veer, try to get to the mic. We have a combo block between center and guard trying to get Mike. It's important to block the Mike backer in triple option. He's going to be the guy. We're going to cut off one, cut off B-gap to climb. Fullback mesh, pitch. Now we're going to seal play side backer. Now in a 4-3, even if this backer plays outside the box, we're going to tell our slot, you load him. You've got him. There's no more wall block. He's played outside. You're going to block him all the way. If that backer were to stick his nose in, then he would climb looking for this backside safety. The receiver can stalk or crack, and we're cutting off on the backside. We don't mind loading our slot on this linebacker because a lot of times if he tries to beat us underneath, we pin him. If he tries to run outside, we'll push him wide, and the quarterback will duck it up underneath. The last defense that we identify is a 50, 7-man front. And to be honest with you, this is probably where we look more a little different than true inside veer teams in terms of scheme against a 50. Now, the identifying characteristic of a 50 to us is a zero nose. Five linemen. There's one, there's two. That's our base dive read in a 50 defense. Fourth defender, same game as the 4-3. Either one of those two. Now what we're going to do is we're going to zone the tackle. Now it's a guard tackle zone, a true zone, and we're going to try to double him into the backer. We're going to scoop the zero nose to backside, cut off B gap, probably stay on the four technique. Hit your crease, hug that double team, quarterback, fullback mesh, stalk or crack, it's up to you, and we're going to wall to backside, to playside backer to backside safety, cut off on the backside receiver. Against a 50 defense, it's a give almost every time as a base rule. So this is our combination triple option play against the five defenses we see. 3 8-man fronts, 2 7-man fronts. Okay, what I'd like to do now after we took a look at our base rules out of ACE against different defenses is because when we get to the video, you'll see some different things we do. Because we want to run triple option out of any formation we get in, we want to look at how our rules have changed with a tight end. We'll take a look at what we call a tent call, and then we'll take a couple of looks at formation adjustments. Anytime we run our combination triple to a tight end, very simple adjustment we make. Our tight end now becomes our wall blocker. So our tight end takes the place of what the slot would normally do. He's going to wall block. Our slot now, if we have a slot there, he's going to do what we call an arc chase because he knows the tight end takes his place. Our arc chase is, and there's dive and there's pitch in this defense. We're out here. He's going to take a wide arc, hopefully stretch this rover to help the quarterback if it's a pull. And then he's going to take a best path to what we call the next deepest defender that's not the pitch key. And many times it's the free safety because we see some good free safeties running the alley on us, and this gives us a way to get a hat on them. But our tight end is still going to be the wall blocker. So that's one adjustment we make with our tight end. He simply becomes the wall blocker. Our slot becomes an arc chase blocker. One adjustment we make or adaptation is what we call a tid call. This happens a lot with a tight end also, but it could be a slot. And it usually happens against a 50 defense. Sometimes in a 50 defense, we'll see a defensive end lined up in a 9 technique or wider on a tight end. And as a result, anytime the dive key, and against a 50, remember we're reading second down linemen, anytime the dive key lines up outside the slot or the tight end, they're going to get to the line, they're going to say, Ted, Ted, Ted. All that means is they're going tight end down. He's going inside because he has a free release to get to the playside backer, and that's going to free these two guys up to combo and double team the down lineman. They don't have to worry about coming off on the linebacker anymore. And when our quarterback and the fullback hears that, they know it's going to be a give. Because anytime we have a dive read that wide, it's going to be a give with a tid call. Another thing we do, adapting the triple, is, and I drew it up early out of balance sets, we don't really get into counting defenders and all that. What we do, we tell our quarterbacks, you're looking for balance. And 99 times out of 100, if we're in an A set, somebody's balanced on us. But when we get in unbalanced, in this formation with our split ends over, and we'll look at it against a 3-3, it really doesn't matter. We love doing this against 8-man fronts that have a good free safety. And what it does, it gives us an extra blocker. And the receiver that comes over does what we call a free block. He's going to go block the free safety because we have an extra blocker. He stalks, dive key, pitch key, nothing changes, and then we perform our normal blocking rules as regular. So now we have dive key, pitch key, and now you have a hat on the free safety. So if you get the ball pulled and you get it pitched, you really have a hat on all the defenders play side. That's really good for a tough free safety in your alley. The only thing we look for when we get unbalanced sets, as far as numbers, is back to what we call the nub rule. Anytime we're in a formation, an unbalanced formation, we can run strong for the most part, but if a defense starts rolling to our unbalanced because of numbers or trying to get extra defenders, if they leave one support defender back away from unbalanced, which we call the nub side, then we incorporate our nub rule. We want to run to that side. And the reason we do is there's two less blocks we have to make. Okay, over here you have to make a wall block, a chase block, and a stalk block. Over here it's dive key, pitch key. All you got to do is block the linebacker, and then he's late running the alley. So it's the path of least resistance. There's fewer defenders you have to account for. So that's adaptations that you'll see on our video next of how we run the triple option. Okay, guys, now we'll take a look at combination triple option in action. I have several, and we're in the order of the defense that we drew them up. We have some 40, 3-3, 5-1, and then some 7-man fronts. And we run them out of multiple formations, so you'll be able to see them out of some of the sets with tight ends, split ends, back to the nub, and that sort of thing. Starting off, we got a 40 defense. Okay, all these are 40 defenses for now. Again, we're coming down here, second down lineman, dive key, pitch key, rover defense. And out of our balance A set, we don't mind running into the boundary. We do all the time. We get a hard pull. You see how we want our quarterback downhill hard at the pitch man. And when it's time to pitch it, he is going to extend and come off to the pitch. And we never get hit by the forced defender. And our slot's in good position to get his shoulder square north to south and gain some positive yardage. Okay, this is still a 40 defense. What we're going to do is we're going to actually walk our tight end, which we do a lot, and that's one reason we have him up. It doesn't affect anything about the play. Now he's going to wall and arc chase, and just watch what it does to that forced defender when that slot arc chases. Again, we get a pull read. See how it makes that rover really widen? Now what we really would like is that slot to be able to get to that free safety. So if he winds that much and the free safety's inside, we'd rather get him. But our tight end's all over the backer. Quarterback's got a nice running lane to get up inside. Okay, this is our two tight set, which we ran a lot this year. For some reason, this tight end's down. We just kind of made a mistake. But we're going to run it down here. You see tight end's going to wall and get a nice crease. We'll take that every play of every game. Watch his reaction. His head and shoulders don't turn down in there. We're going to give the football all night long. Fullback hits the crease. Nice yard. It's adaptable to all formations. Now we're going to run into our unbalanced set with split ends. All we've done now is taken him and we're going to a free block. So they have a good free safety on this team, so it gives us a hat on the free safety. If you look at the wall block stretches. Quarterback does a nice job of not forcing the issue of trying to get outside the wall block on a very good linebacker, so we'll duck it up inside and get what we can. Pitch is dead. At that point, we're just going to run the football. The worst thing we do on this play is fumble it late. But you get a good look at it. All right, a little shifting we do. Sometimes we start a game or do something another team hadn't seen. Again, this is a 40 defense. We're walking a tight end, bumping out a receiver. That's one good thing about having a wide out in a tight end. This is a 40 defense, dive key, pitch key. You'll see him wall, arc chase. Guard does a poor job of cutting off first down lineman backside, but we're able to get away with it. Pull read, pitch. Again, that's why I really like how we pitch the football. Once that rover gives us a pitch reaction, we're going off, we're falling off to the pitch man. It's over with. Get his shoulder square. Good stalk block on the perimeter. That's one thing your split ends better do in this offense is long stalk blocking. Okay, now we're going to run the play again and unbalance. And I put this one on here. We got a fire and rover. Probably worst case scenario. Rover disregards him because he's ineligible. He's still going to crack the free safety. We just, if that's happening during the game, we need to be smart and start cutting our split. We get a dive, fast pitch. We got a hat on a hat, and you see there's nothing but grass. Team in green is very, very fast. We also see some stemming. Right before the snap, the defense is going to stem shades. Our guys do a great job of taking like come. Look at the play side tackle. That's exactly what we want, is for him to keep his shoulder square. Help the three technique if he has to, get the linebacker. We still get the crack on the free on number 10, and we got a nice running lane. Now, this is a nub rule. Same team, same game. We feel like they're very conscious over here. This corner has rolled back enough to where he's almost over the ball. And he's a cornerback. He's not a free safety. So we don't mind him running the alley too much. Here's one support defender. We're going to run play to the nub rule. It's a little freeze play we do every now and then, false motion, just to keep them honest over there, try to see their stunts. You get a give read so the numbers don't matter on the perimeter. Okay, One thing I meant to talk about, just didn't get to, was into trips. Into trips, and we'll see the wide copy, we will run our triple option into our trips look as long as we feel like we can secure the play side linebacker with our guard and tackle. And this team was playing a tight inside A-gap backer, and we felt like we could get away with it. I have a wide shot of this one to show you how we get a crack on a free safety and get the backer secured. Again, we want to be able to run this play into all our sets. A little bit dated film, but if we feel like we can get this backer, it's a little bit of a gamble, but your scouting report helps you that. We're going to crack the free with him. We're going to twirl motion. Dive key, pitch key never changes. So, again, we want our triple to be adaptable to all formations. We get a pull, dive key, play soft, we crack the free, and there's nobody left. Okay, now we move to a 3-3 defense. Didn't see this defense a lot this year. This is one of the only team that played it on us. Zero stack is one, second down lineman. Force is out here. We'll look at it from the wide. We get a hard pull. Now, that's a case where it's a quick reaction because the dive key is pinching across our tackle's face. When our quarterback sees that, he's going to get out of that mesh fast, gets a fast pitch reaction, gets the ball pitched. We got numbers on the perimeter on the defense here, but we just don't do a really good job of maintaining the stalk block. This does not have to be a kill shot. This can be a soft stalk block. Just got to cut him off. And a good athlete in open field makes it tough. You can see the quarterback does a good job of pitching the football and falling off. Okay, 5-1 defense. We got an end zone copy of this. Five down linemen, Mike Backer. These two are your rovers. We count on them fitting outside. Dive key, pitch key. This was in our state championship game this past year. A heck of a football team on defense there. It was really, really a tough game. Did some good things. Tough defense. Zero stack, 1-2. Watch the dive key's reaction all the way. I see our slot's going to be in an arc chase block. He's going to free safety all the way. Anytime we get a 5-1 defense, we're going to arc chase all the way. Combo read this, scoop on the backside. We're going to switch on the backside. Tackle does a good job. It just needs to be a little flatter, a little lower. Get a give read. Let your fullback. You got to be willing to let your fullback win the game for you guys if you run this offense. Okay, another 5-1 defense out of two tights. Dive key, pitch key. Now, here's a good read because here's a case where our defensive end is trying to read the mesh, so to speak, and tell who's got the ball. He turns his shoulders, but he's not coming down in there flat. And you can see the crease we get zoning up this with a TED call. That's an example of a TED call also with our tight end going inside to the mic. Trying to arc to the corner. Free safety's got to make the tackle for a nice game. Okay, 5-1 again. Five down lineman. Second down lineman. Force defender. Watch the zone block between the guard and tackle on the four. This is what we really like about this scheme. Great movement into the Mike backer. Zone, tackle comes off, secures a nice, nice running lane for the fullback. As in any zone blocking concept, we want to ensure the down lineman before we come off. Okay, now we get to the 4-3, seven-man fronts. It's a 4-3 defense. Second down lineman, force defenders outside. You can't see him. I do have a wide copy on here, and you can see how we react off the crack block. We get a pull. Cornerback goes to pitch. Now, the backside end is running us down pretty close. So, again, what we tell our tackle is you cut off the B-gap, but don't shorten the corner. If he doesn't have a B-gap threat, he ought to rip through the inside half of that backside end just so he didn't run us down. Two safety look. He decides who the pitch key is. If the safety's high, he should crack him, and we'll make him the pitch key, and that's what he does this time. He cracks. That makes the corner the pitch key. Corners almost always go to pitch. 4-3 defense, same team. Dive key. Now this time you'll see from the wide the safety is not crackable, so the quarterback is going to make, or excuse me, wide out lets the safety be the pitch key. He flies the pitch also. So same look. Just didn't feel like we tell our wideouts, do not force the crack. Because if you try to come, say the secondary coaches hate to get cracked. If he tries to come in there and crack and he turns his back to us and we end up with two unblocked defenders, when in doubt, we're going to stalk the perimeter. I didn't say this on the rules, but as a base rule, our linemen are securing the pass for the fullback. Our slot is blocking for the quarterback, and the perimeter is blocking for the quarterback or pitch. This is a 4-3. This is an adjustment we love to make out of trips against a 4-3 team and run the triple option week. We feel like they're going to roll to cover three. We make the dive key. Now we pitch off the outside linebacker if we need to. But we get a give read all the way. I'll show you a wide angle of this. When we see a 4-3 team, we love to get in trips and run the triple weak. And all we tell the quarterback now, second down lineman, but we'll make the back of the pitch key. Usually they roll their safeties to cover three look to the trips, single safeties deep, and we feel like we have a great play every time over here. Give our pitch. Fullback does a nice job hitting that crease. Again, I think it's important the quarterback have a one-way thought process on all these plays. Think give, react to a pull. It's a 50 defense, the last defense we'll look at. A 50 defense, zero nose. We run it to a tight end. He's dive key, tight end wall, arc chase with the slot. One thing about that tight end stepping out also, we'll make an end want to step with him, as you see there. He doesn't want to get reached. A lot of times that just opens up the lane for your fullback. The guard is wrong here. He should be zoning to the four. We got a little mixed up on our call. I don't want you to think that something we do is block down on a zero nose, because we don't. Our guard should have been zoning to the tackle there. This is a 50 defense. It's a little different looking 50 because they're reduced down. Some people call this an eagle. We're in our two tight set, second down lineman, force defender. You'll see our tight end makes a Ted call and really doesn't get to the backer. We don't force a Ted call. See, the backer's getting out. We get away with it. But we really want our tight end. Do not risk it if you feel like that backer's not gonna feel. You get a pitch reaction. Again, the quarterback does a nice job of falling off the pitch. Here's a 50 also, which we like to do is run just like a 4-3, seven-man front. We like to run a triple away from trips. We feel like we have a dive key and really no defined pitch key, so we could pitch off a backer from the inside, or really once the quarterback gets a pull, a lot of times he's just going to be able to run the football. You see a nice zone there between the guard and the tackle. Nice, easy read. Stand-up defenders tend to be more quarterback players. Hands-down defenders tend to be more dive players, as a general rule, but our quarterback is always think and give, react to a pull. Okay, 50. We're going to walk our tight end. This team is going to stem on us. They're in a 4-3. They stem. Doesn't affect us. Quarterback just makes a call. 50-50. Lets us know. Now we run a triple here. And that's one thing, probably the biggest thing I like about our scheme compared to true inside veer. True inside veer, you know, is going to read this dive key, pitch off of him, and have to arc block. We don't want to take our fullback out of the game. So this crease, we're going to actually end up base blocking, but we should try to zone unless the back is a threat. He's the dive key against the 50. It's going to be a give almost every time. Fullback does a good job hitting the crease and getting the shoulder square. One thing I like to do is take a look at how we adjust this play, very flexible versus certain things defenses are doing. Just call it problem defenses. Before I do that, I want to mention a note about motion on our slots before I forget. Our slot motion is controlled by our slots. We take that off the quarterback, and we want our slot motions always late and fast. We don't want to be slow and deliberate. We want them a step and a half to two steps at the most, full speed on all our motions, but especially our triple option motion. Against a 40 defense, a couple of adjustments we'll make if we're having problems. The first is what we call a block scheme, and it involves a tight end. When we call block, we're going to take our tight end, and we're going to steal wall block and dive key. This is still a trip option play. But now we're going to take our slot and show arc to this rover who may be stretching and just pin him out. Corners tend to be locked into running to pitch. We didn't run this a lot last year, but 40 defenses tend to get really locked in into play and dive, quarterback, pitch, and this goes against what they're trying to do responsibility-wise. And what ends up happening is quarterback, he knows he can pitch off a corner if he gets there, but we end up getting turned up north and south and have a nice game. And if your free safety's over there, he tends to overlap the play as well. So we call that block. Also against a 40, we'll call run a scheme that was really good to us late in the year out of two tights. We like it because it's balanced. But when a 40 team starts really reducing their defense because in two tights, it's almost like a goal line set. And we have the ability to run some power plays at you. But if the team starts really reducing down, we'll say, okay, we're going to make the rover this dive key. The rover is what we term an outside backer. And when we do this, all triple option blocking is the same, except now our tight end and our tackle are going to double this end to this backer. Our slot's going to come down and seal level two, and we're going dive key, pitch key, and adjust it. Now, when you look at this play, a lot of people tend to think, well, you got to adjust your path. We don't. That's one thing we like about this scheme. We're going to still hit that crease because we tell our fullback when we're in a rover scheme, you expect the ball and you expect to read that double team and slide off of there. But even if that double team were to widen or this backer walked up and our tackle had to come inside, we can always hit that crease. It's easier for a fullback to run inside out than outside in, and that's what we like about that compared to an outside veer or wider path. Against a 4-3, two things we'll do. Based on what they're doing with those outside backers, remember 4-3, those guys can get a lot of different places. If they're widening this backer so wide that he's hard to handle, or we just say we just want to pitch it off of him, then we'll tag this play with arc. And when we go arc, as a lot of veer teams do this, we're still reading second down lineman or reading two, cutting off back here. But now we're saying we're going to make our backer the pitch key. We can either stalk or switch this. Anytime we run an arc block in play, our slot is going to arc and he's going to read off the corner. If that corner is stalking, he knows he's arcing to safety. If our wide out is cracking, he knows he's arcing or kicking out the corner. So we go dive key, pitch key off the backer against a 4-3. The other thing we do against a 4-3 is a little scheme we call tray. Very simple play. It's when teams give us a 6-1 look. A true 6-1, maybe they're, you know, we're really beating them up inside, midline and that kind of stuff, and they start reducing those inside gaps, and we say kind of like a rover scheme, except it applies to a 4-3. We're going to make the third down lineman or the back of the dive key and still pitch off a force, but it's probably going to be a give. And all we do there, still zone. Now our tackle's got the tough block to do something with him. A lot of times he may be pinching. Our fullback's going to hit that B-gap crease, and he's going to run off of that area. Now our slot can either wall or Ted. We talked about Ted. We can either stalk or crack, and everything else is the same, motion and cutoff. So that's an adjustment we make against 4-3. And the last scheme is against a 50. We call it veer load. Remember, against a 50, we're reading that wide defensive end player. This involves a tight end for us. When we run against a 50, we may be getting, we'll do it out of end over, strong safety, free safety, corner. Let's say we're running our regular triple option and we're getting a lot of give reads, but we're not really getting good movement in here on this four, this backer, and they're really good players. We'll get to our veer scheme where we're going to get old true down veer blocking. Boom, boom, boom. Those three are going to combo to those two. And now our tackle is going to veer inside, and we're going to actually read the first down lineman, which is the read that a lot of teams read on the inside veer. The difference is we're protecting the mesh still. We're not turning a big 280-pounder loose on our 190-pound fullback. We're still protecting mesh. Now we're going to tell our tight end to load him, do what he can with him. Our slot's going to be lined up here. He's going to fit in here, wall, chase off of that. And now we go dive key here, pitch key, stalk the corner. What happens a lot of times, guys, you'll see on film, we still hit that crease. The one thing we tell our fullback here is expect to square up hard because we're reading a tighter defender. Motion to pitch is when our quarterback gets a pull, which it almost always is against this type of look, is if this block stretches, we turn up off tackle. It's up almost like a quarterback off tackle. If we get this block loaded, then we'll pull it, come on outside and option the rover for the possible pitch. So that's a few adjustments that we'll look at on video of how we keep our triple option play going against problem defenses. Okay, let's take a look at a couple of these adjustments that we talked about. Again, we don't force these schemes. We want to run our base triple option. It's when somebody's giving us a problem or we feel like there's something we can take advantage of. The first you'll see is what we call our block scheme. It's going to end up a 40 defense. We walk in a tight end, and you can see they're a little confused, but it ends up being a 40 front with two backers. Now, remember, our tight end is going to wall, and he's going to arc and kick out the rover, which if we get a pull, it's going to be a nice running lane for the quarterback. We get the pull. Now, really see how the corner of the free safety right there is running the alley? It really plays against their responsibilities because, you know, that free safety is thinking he's got quarterback all the way. Well, he's getting arced, and we kick him out, creates a nice running lane for the quarterback. Worst case scenario is the free safety runs the alley tighter. Then we got 5 or 6 yards in our quarterback one-on-one with the free safety, which is not a bad matchup because we're going north and south. Okay, this is our rover scheme. This is our rover scheme. We feel like if the 40 defense starts reducing enough, especially out of two tights, we're going to combo this guy into the backer, and we're going to read him. But our fullback's crease does not change. He just expects to slide off of that combo. And we get great movement there. See, that end is not used to getting down blocked because we very rarely down block with our tight end. And we put him for a ride, and there's a lot of room to run in there. It's always easy when you get that kind of movement, but again, think about this player. He's got to think dive, quarterback, or get blocked now. We're going to run rover again. He's the rover. He's the read. We know it's a give 100% of the time. See, the fullback does a great job. He hits that crease, and then he adjusts off that tackle. He just slides into the C gap. Right there, a nice game. Again, we'll live all day long with that as long as somebody will give it to us. Okay, 4-3 adjustments. This is a 4-3 team, two safeties. This backer was playing really wide, plus he was pretty tough, hard for our slots to block. So now we're going to say we're going to arc and we're going to dive key, pitch key. And we end up pitching off of that outside backer. Very poor arc block here. We should switch this, number one, but we're not bad stalking. Is our slot, you can tell he's looking for the crack. He just doesn't get himself in position. Anytime we're perimeter blocking, we got to match their aggressiveness. That is a long, tough block. We got to be athletic, and we can't just be out of control there. We got to be under control and balanced. Okay, this is our trace game. This is a dated play. Be honest with you, we very rarely, for whatever reason, see 6-1 defenses. We just don't see them very much. But this is a 6-1. I got a wide angle. 6 down lineman. We're reading him. We're going to zone in base. He actually makes a TED call. And that's a give similar to a rover play against a 6-1. You can see it wide. This is a slot making a TED call because we're in a trade scheme reading him. Slot's going to the mic backer. That's the guy you got a TED to in that defense. Okay, this is veer block. This is our 50 adjustments. We're in our tight end overset. Again, we've been getting give reads, but not a lot of movement. Now we're going to read him, load him. Pitch off him if we get there. Now, if you look at the fullback guys, he's kind of staying on his path and running right into that big defensive lineman. He's a first-time starter as a sophomore. He got a lot better, but we want him to square up and absorb that and make that tackle come get him. Tight end is going to load the defensive end. That block stretches. It becomes an off-tackle play for the quarterback. So it's a little change up against the 50 defense in terms of what they're trying to do and what they're used to seeing. The rover fits outside, nice gain up inside. Same thing down here, 50 defense. We're going to go veer load, read the four down, load the backer. Now the fullback does a little better job of squaring it up in there. Tight end gets his man reach this time, which he doesn't have to. And we're in a position right there where we could have pitched if that rover would have forced us. The slot's wrong. He ought to be going back at a free. Instead, he's trying to block the pitch key. He was young, too. But you can see that can fit off tackle. It really attacks the defense in a lot of different ways. Guys, it's been my pleasure today to share with you this information on our combination triple option. We think it's a unique blend of inside and outside veer principles. Some of the problems that you have with both plays, we think we have a pretty good solution for with this scheme. And it's been really, really good to us. Just a note about triple option football in general. I think triple option is something that you've got to commit to. Otherwise, I would not run it. It can't be a play that you're going to say, this week we're going to run a triple option and next week we're not. I think if you try to take that approach, the triple option will be more harm than good to you as far as production. You have a lot of fumbles, a lot of turnovers, a lot of frustration. So if you're going to run a triple option play, I think this is an excellent scheme, but I highly recommend that you spend time on it, both in season, off season, every day. Every day we're going to commit time to reads and mesh and script it in our team section of our practice. So triple option is a great play, but it is also a very demanding play in terms of time and execution and details. So if I could ever help you in any way, please don't hesitate to call. Thank you.